Hello everyone, welcome to this session on sectional anatomy of abdomen and pelvis. Okay, so in this image we can get a brief overview of how a sectional anatomy of abdomen looks like. Okay, so in this particular session, what all particular topics we'll be covering? So these are the list of topics that I'll be covering in this particular session. I'll be covering a cross section at T12 vertebrae and cross section at L1 vertebrae and mid sagittal section of male pelvis and female pelvis. Okay, and as far as exam point of view is concerned, these two sections are very important because in practical exams there are specific specimens for this mid sagittal section of male pelvis and female pelvis. Okay, so let's begin with the cross section at T12 vertebrae. In this image, we can see cross section at T12 vertebrae. So before beginning with the section, first we'll have to orient ourselves towards the image. So here I have given the orientation marks. So this is the anterior aspect. This is the posterior aspect. Okay. And this is the left side and this is the right side. Okay. Whenever we study sections, we always study from the inferior aspect. Okay. Because later on when we learn about the CT scan and MRI, most of the sections are taken or they are studied or viewed from the inferior aspect. Okay, so if we learn gross anatomy with an image viewed from the inferior aspect, later on it will be easy for us to identify the various CT scan and MRI images. Okay, so this is the cross section of the abdomen cut and viewed from the inferior aspect. So what all structures we can appreciate in this image? What is this question mark structure? So this is the large organ, that is the liver. Okay, so when we cut and view from the inferior aspect, on the right side the large organ which will be visible is liver. Okay, so nowadays in postgraduate examinations, image based questions are asked. So at times in cross section, any structure they can label and they can ask in multiple choice questions. Okay, so that's why sectional anatomy is also very important. Okay. And what all other structures we can see in this particular section? This is the stomach which is seen. Then which are these two structures? This is the right kidney. This is the left kidney. Okay, this is the abdominal aorta. And this is inferior vena cava. What is this structure? First of all, what is this? Connecting the liver and the stomach, there's a part of the peritoneum which is referred to as the lesser omentum. Okay, so this is the lesser omentum and this is the right free margin of the lesser omentum containing portal vein, hepatic artery and bile duct. Okay, so this is the right free margin and just behind the right free margin, this space which we can see, this is the epiploic foramen. Okay, epiploic foramen is the communication between greater sac and the lesser sac. Okay, so just behind the stomach, this space which is seen, this is the lesser sac, and this S stands for the spleen which is present on the left side. Okay, and apart from that, which all structures are seen in this section? Here we can see the body of the vertebrae, T12 vertebrae. Then this, here is the spinal cord. Then adjacent to the spinous process of the vertebrae, we can see erector spinae group of muscles. Okay. Then when we come on the anterior aspect, which muscle is this? This is the rectus abdominis. And this is the muscles of the anterior abdominal wall. Okay, there are three muscles in anterior abdominal wall: external oblique, internal oblique, and transversus abdominis. These are all the various structures seen in this particular section. And for abdominal aorta, T12 is a very important landmark because it is at this level that the descending thoracic aorta continues as the abdominal aorta. Okay. And one more very important topic with respect to this section is epiploic foramen, which is just behind this right free margin. Okay, so we'll learn a little more details about this epiploic foramen. So here we can see a cross section of the at the level of epiploic foramen. So schematic diagram to show various relations of epiploic foramen. So this arrow mark is in the epiploic foramen. Okay, it's also referred to as foramen of Winslow. Okay, so two names for this particular region, that is the epiploic foramen, also referred to as foramen of Winslow, the communication between greater sac and lesser sac. Okay, so this is the lesser sac which is shown here. This is the stomach. So just behind the stomach is the lesser sac. Okay, this shows the lesser omentum, and this is the right pre-margin of the lesser omentum containing portal vein, hepatic artery, and bile duct. Okay, so this is the portal vein. Bile duct is towards the right side, hepatic artery is towards the left side, and behind both these structures is the portal vein. Okay. So how to remember this, which structure is to the right, which structure is to the left? We can remember the duct is dexter. Okay, dexter, the word means it refers to the right side. Okay. So on the right side there is bile duct, on the left side there is hepatic artery, and behind both these structures is the portal vein. So which all relations of epiploic foramen we can learn from this image? Anterior relation of epiploic foramen is the right pre-margin of the lesser omentum containing portal vein, hepatic artery, and bile duct. Posterior relation is this. Which structure is this? This is the inferior vena cava. Okay. Posterior relation of epiploic foramen is inferior vena cava, and behind which is C12 vertebrae. Okay. So anterior and posterior relations we can learn from this image. Superior and inferior relations, how we can remember? Where do we find for epiploic foramen in a dissected specimen? Just behind the right pre-margin. Okay, we place the finger just behind the right pre-margin. So if you imagine, just below the finger is the first part of the duodenum. Okay, the pylorus continues as the first part of the duodenum. So inferior relation is the first part of the duodenum, and the superior relation is the caudate lobe of the liver. Okay, so liver is above, first part of duodenum is below, anteriorly is right pre-margin of lesser omentum containing portal vein, hepatic artery, and bile duct. Posterior relation is inferior vena cava, behind which is C12 vertebrae. Okay, so these are the various relations of epiploic foramen which we should be knowing. Now let's cover the cross section at L1 vertebrae. L1 is a very important landmark in abdomen. If you have learnt about the various quadrants of the abdomen, there are two vertical planes and two horizontal planes which divides the abdomen into nine quadrants, right? The upper horizontal plane, it corresponds to the L1 vertebrae. Okay, upper horizontal plane is also referred to as transpyloric plane. Okay, so what anatomical structure we can expect in this section? We can expect the pylorus of the stomach. Okay, so this region, which we can say this is the region of pylorus of the stomach. Okay, and there are many other structures which are similar to the previous section. Here we can see the liver, then kidney, right kidney, left kidney, and spleen. Okay, so these all structures we saw in the previous image as well. And this P, which is mentioned, this is the pancreas. The region of the neck of the pancreas. Behind the neck of the pancreas, there's an important anatomical event, that is the union of superior mesenteric vein and splenic vein to form the portal vein. Okay, so here's the formation of portal vein, and here this is the inferior vena cava and abdominal aorta. Then these are the coils of the jejunum. Then this is the splenic flexure of the colon, which will continue as the descending colon. And this is the transverse colon, and this green color structure is gallbladder. Okay, so these are the various structures seen at the level of L1 vertebrae. Okay. There is one labeled image for this. You all can just go through all the labeling. So there are some additional labelings also shown in this image. Peritoneal cavity is shown, linea alba. And falciform ligament connects the anterior aspect of the liver to the anterior abdominal wall. Then diaphragm is labeled. Okay. Then there is one artery which is labeled here, superior mesenteric artery. It's a branch of anterior branch of abdominal aorta. So rest all, most of the things we have covered in the previous image. Let's compare a gross anatomy specimen with a specimen of CT scan. Okay, how does a CT image look like as compared to the gross specimen? Here we can see CT scan. Whenever we see a CT scan, the bones will be looking bright white color. Okay. Here we can see the spinous first of the vertebrae, and these are the ribs which are cut and they are looking bright white. So here is the right kidney. You can compare it with this gross specimen. Right kidney, right? Liver. Then here is the spleen. In this, here is the spleen. And here is the coils of intestines which are seen. Okay. So when you learn about the gross specimen, it will become easy for you to identify the various structures later on when you see the CT scan and MRI images. Okay, that's why cross section is important, and always this orientation is important. Okay, always we learn the cross sectional anatomy from the inferior aspect. Now let's cover the mid sagittal section of male pelvis and female pelvis. Okay, so in this image, what we can see is the mid sagittal section of a male pelvis. Let me give orientation to this image. This is the anterior aspect, posterior aspect, superior and inferior. So in exams, mid sagittal sections of male and female pelvis are kept, and mostly are asked to identify various structures from anterior to posterior. Okay, so anterior most, there are genitals, then here there is the pubic symphysis. Just behind the pubic symphysis there is urinary bladder. Okay, this is the urinary bladder, and there is a small space in between pubic symphysis and urinary bladder. This space is referred to as the retropubic space, also referred to as retropubic space of Retzius. Okay, R-E-T-Z-I-U-S, Retzius. Okay, so the urinary bladder, which will continue as the urethra, and surrounding here we can see this is the prostate gland. Then behind urinary bladder, this structure is the rectum, and behind rectum this is sacrum. Okay, and when we see the folds of the peritoneum between rectum and urinary bladder, there will be a one fold of peritoneum which is referred to as rectovesical pouch. Okay, when you see, when you learn about the female mid sagittal pelvis, there will be two pouches which will be seen, because between urinary bladder and rectum there is an organ intervening, that is the uterus. Okay, between urinary bladder and rectum there is a small sheet of fascia which is referred to as rectovesical fascia of Denonvillius. Okay, and in front of the sacrum also there is a fascia which is referred to as presacral fascia of Waldeyer. Okay, these are certain fancy names which you need to remember, which at times can be asked in multiple choice questions. Okay, so I'll repeat again, between urinary bladder and rectum there is rectovesical fascia of Denonvillius, and in front of the sacrum there is presacral fascia of Waldeyer. Okay, and what is this image? This is MRI image of the mid sagittal section of male pelvis. Okay, whenever we learn about the soft tissue structures, MRI is preferred. Okay, and whenever we have to learn about hard structures, then that means bones, if you have to study, then CT scan is preferred. Okay, soft tissues are more clearly seen in MRI. So here is the genitals, and this is pubic symphysis, then urinary bladder, and rectum is not seen clearly. So somewhere here is the rectum. Okay, so let's see a gross specimen of mid sagittal section of male pelvis. So here we can see a gross specimen. So here this is pubic symphysis, then urinary bladder, and this is rectum. Okay, and if you learn about the fold of peritoneum between rectum and urinary bladder, there will be rectovesical pouch. So in the mid sagittal section, mostly will be asked to identify various structures from anterior to posterior. Okay, So if you have seen an image and learnt it, you'll be able to answer an exam. So let's see, metasagittal section of female pelvis. In this image, we can see metasagittal section of female pelvis. Again, the orientation remains the same: anterior, posterior, superior, inferior. The anterior most structure which is seen here, this is the pubic symphysis, then urinary bladder, uterus is the structure intervening between urinary bladder and rectum. Okay. And behind rectum is sacrum. So just like I told you previously, between rectum and uterus, there's a fold of peritoneum which is referred to as rectouterine pouch. Between urinary bladder and uterus, there is bassicouterine pouch. Okay. So this pouch, you can remember, from rectum to uterus is rectouterine pouch. Between urinary bladder and uterus is bassicouterine pouch. Then behind urinary bladder, in the upper part you will see uterus, and in the lower part there will be vagina. Okay. And when you trace the rectum, that's the anal canal. And in male pelvis, I told you about rectovesical fascia of Denon-Villiers. That won't be present in female pelvis. Okay, but this presacral fascia of Waldeyer's, that will be present. So again, this is an MRI image of the metasagittal section of female pelvis. So here we can see this is the pubic symphysis, then urinary bladder, uterus, and this is the rectum. And behind rectum is again sacrum. Okay. Now again, let's see the gross specimen of metasagittal section of female pelvis. Here we can see the gross specimen. Again, let's try to identify various structures. This is the pubic symphysis, and here is the urinary bladder. This is uterus, and this is rectum. Okay, and behind rectum, this is sacrum. Okay, so we'll be able to identify various structures from anterior to posterior. Okay, at times only specimen will be there, and you will have to identify whether it is metasagittal section of male pelvis or female pelvis. Okay, for that you'll have to look for this organ. If uterus is present, that means it is a metasagittal section of female pelvis. Otherwise, you can say as the male pelvis. Okay, and also in male pelvis, external genitalia, testes, and scrotum will be seen. Okay. So let's summarize what we have covered in this particular session. So we learned the cross section at T12 vertebrae. What important anatomical landmark was there in at T12? One was epiploic foramen. Then T12 is also a landmark for abdominal aorta. The descending thoracic aorta continues as the abdominal aorta. Okay, and various other structures we learned. And L1 is the important anatomical landmark for transpyloric plane, which divides the anterior abdominal wall into 9 quadrants. Okay, so pylorus of the stomach will be seen at this section. And other structures also we identified. And whenever we learn cross sections, we should make sure that we are drawing diagrams which are viewed from the inferior aspect. Okay, and orientations are very important. And we learned about the metasagittal section of male pelvis, female pelvis, MRI images of male and female pelvis, as well as gross specimen images. Okay, so this was all about this particular session. For PDF handout of this particular session, you can WhatsApp me at this number, and please do watch the other sessions of this YouTube channel. Okay, thank you.